They change cultures. They're heat seekers. They run at adversity and embrace change. These are the room tilters.
Somebody who can change the temperature in a room when they walk in. Mm. And that's metaphorical for somebody who can influence those around them and make it such an impact quickly, emphatically, and long-lasting, whether it be an organization, a team, a relationship, whatever it might be.
This is the Room Tilters podcast, presented by Limitless Minds. Co-hosts DJ Eitzen and Harry Wilson, founders of peak performance and leadership consulting company, Limitless Minds, explore how the best and brightest change the temperature in a room. From sports, the military, entertainment and media, clinical psychologists to CEOs, this podcast will navigate what it takes to think big and go far. And now, DJ and Harry.
All right. Well, we're here on another Room Tilters podcast. Excited for something a little different today. DJ, what's up, brother?
What's up? How's it going?
Good, man. Good. Well, I'm excited to introduce our listeners to a friend, coworker, peer. Matt Nickel is on. Matt Nickel is our digital product manager at Limitless Minds. Known Matt for, you know, a couple of years now. And we ran into each other as he worked at a client of ours. And he also had this awesome podcast called the Humble and Hungry podcast. But Matt is a super creative dude, talented, you know, can kind of do it all, kind of a Swiss Army knife kind of guy from tech to, you know, creative and marketing, et cetera. So he's been a tremendous part to our team, bringing a tremendous amount of value to our Limitless Minds team. We thought it'd be cool to bring him on for a couple of reasons. One, he's fun and awesome. Two, DJ and I kind of have this pent up amount of like kind of dialogue we wanted to talk about relative to COVID-19, the coronavirus. And, you know, like we're dealing with this much like our listeners are, you know, our next door neighbors. It's something that is unprecedented and we're all kind of navigating it. And so we thought we'd bring on a friend of ours that knows how to manage a podcast to come on and host and join us. So Matt, thanks for coming on.
Well, thanks, Harry. Thanks for the introduction and great to be with you guys this lovely day as we're facing COVID-19 and glad to be on and glad to be part of the greater Limitless Minds company and a fan of the Room Tilters podcast and all the amazing guests you guys have had on. So thanks for having me on. And you know, I was thinking of just asking you guys some questions about, you know, how you guys are dealing with COVID-19 and kind of pick your brains on how to approach this with the right mindset, maybe some practical things you guys are doing or just even things that are going through your mind. I think a lot of this is just processing. You know, there's a lot of unknowns and there's a lot of things that we're finding out on a daily basis. So processing those things with friends and people that you respect, I think, is super helpful. So just to get started, just throw this out there to you guys. How are you guys holding up? You know, how are you doing emotionally? And how has this COVID-19 thing affected you and your family?
Yeah, no, great question. And it, you know, it's funny. And we talk about this a lot as a team. It's really like not even day to day. It's almost hour to hour. You're getting information and trying to process it. And you're processing it in a way where you're saying, how is this information affecting my family? How is it affecting my business, my people, the people that I'm leading? How's it affecting my community? And so there's all these things that you're trying to process on a day-to-day basis, you know, as we're kind of all going through this together. And so, you know, I feel like, you know, we're holding up pretty well. I think that the people you surround yourself with are important during this time. The information that you take in is important, that you're monitoring that. And I think that all helps you hold up in a certain way. Now, I will say there definitely are challenges. I think about not only from a business perspective, I'll just talk about, you know, home life. When you talk about with our family, having five kids at the house learning and my wife going from, you know, a stay at home mom who much of her work was done in the morning, getting kids ready for school. During the day, you know, she had a certain routine around taking care of some of the things, you know, that she does around the house and different errands and things that she runs and things that she's involved with. But then after school, it was, you know, very activity laced. And now that's been just flipped upside down. No activities. And she's become a teacher. That's a new world. And that brings a certain amount of stress to the house. That brings a certain amount of stress to the overall family. She's doing an unbelievable job. But trying to manage that is a whole different, you know, animal. And so, yeah, so there's definitely a new normal, Matt. You know, trying to navigate through it is been challenging. But there's also been a lot of a lot of really cool things that have happened to as a result.
For me, it's been hard to identify if this is a new normal or not, right? I mean, it's for me where I live, you know, all the restrictions and stuff are pretty new. You know, certainly our travel, our business travel has decreased, and that's been a few weeks now, but it's hard to tell, like, is this a new normal or is this like just a new temporary? You know, are we, how long is this going to last? I think that's part of the challenge for everybody listening and otherwise, is just the uncertainty, not really knowing. You know, if you told me, you know, hey, this is going to be a 4-week thing, right? And here's the date it's going to end, right? 8 weeks. Hell, if you told me if it was going to be 3 months, 5 months, whatever, and you just gave me a timeline, I could, you know, many of us could probably deal, right? We could plan, we could structure, and it would be one thing. But the uncertainty, I think, is what's challenging. So for me, I think two things have kind of increased. One is pressure. You know, it seems like there's a lot of pressure, right? Pressure to take care of my family, to, you know, to provide for my business to still succeed during a time like this, and leadership role to respond. And those are just tough, right? And pressure is something that we all feel. It's just how much of it can we handle, right? And then I think also the other thing that's increased, which is great, is the togetherness. You know, I think that's what I'm noticing is, you know, it seems like whenever we have times, quote, times like this, and in this case, we've never had really a time like this, but when we have these major challenges that are global or impact the nation, we tend to wrap our arms around each other. In this case, it's tough because typically we say, hey, especially in America, right? We say, hey, you know what, 9/11, we're going to come together. We're not going to let it stop us from, you know, doing what we do on a daily basis. In this case, it's like all the things we do on a daily basis, we can't do, right? We shouldn't do, at least. And so how do you remain together, but from a distance? But I think we found creative ways to do that. And the togetherness is interesting to see, even if it's from a distance. So I think that's pretty interesting.
Tell us a little bit about, like, what does it look like in your household? Are you trying to work? You got kids running around. I know this has affected, you know, even your sister's basketball season. I'm just curious, and like, you know, how is your family reacting to this?
It hasn't really sunk in yet, because it honestly kind of almost seems like an extended, you know, spring break or something, just because we haven't been in there. We haven't been cooped up long enough yet. But I think the homeschooling is just a complete, you know, like, new thing for everyone, right? It's like, you know, just the tech involved, and all of a sudden having to become a teacher, like that, like DJ said, it's like, whoa, how do you even do this, right? I mean, I don't even, the math they teach, for example, is just different, just little things like that. But, you know, I think the pressure, I think the challenge is, like, my wife, Courtney, she's unbelievable, right? And DJ's wife, Jess, like, they're super women, right? So they keep everything together. But my wife, she works, and she's an attorney, and so she's got hours, and she's still having to work, and that's for another podcast. But she is. And so, you know, she feels a lot of pressure, right, to make sure, like, Gracie's set up, right, for her school day, her virtual school day, and not knowing how it's going, you know, virtually. So there's different challenges there. But I mean, like I said, I think we're still trying to get used to it and trying to figure out how long, is this something we really need to change our process, you know, or is this something we just need to adapt to briefly, right? I'm not quite sure yet. Unfortunately, I think it might be the former. I think it might be something we're really going to have to make a new norm for at least an extended period of time. So I don't know, man, we're still kind of figuring it out. It's not easy. I mean, it really hasn't been. So.
Yeah, I totally agree. And in reflecting with this whole COVID-19, you kind of touched on it, Harry. Let's talk a little bit about, like, what are the silver lining? You know, what are the best parts about this COVID-19 thing? Obviously, there's a lot to worry about and a lot of fear out there and unknown, but there are some positive things that are coming from this. So I'm curious what you guys are seeing as being kind of the highlights or the best things that are coming out of this COVID-19.
Yeah, you know, one thing I've seen outside of business, and I'll touch on business here in a second, but you see, and Harry mentioned this earlier, you're seeing communities come together. You're seeing people come together. I think this has been really awesome, you know, for that. You know, I mentioned to you guys earlier that our neighborhood had the St. Patrick's Day party over a Zoom call. So we still got to see everybody, right? And we communicated in a way over that. And it was all love on that call. Harry's community did some interesting things too that highlighted how together they are. So that's been really cool. The opportunity to not be on the road and to come home. I have fitness at 5 with my kids. So 5-something, right? Sometimes it's 5:15, sometimes it's 5:55. But during that 5 o'clock hour, we do 10 different exercises. I take them through some things, whether it's, you know, we really like to work our legs in the Eitzen household, as Harry knows, you know, with squats and lunges. So we do some of that. We shoot baskets, we jump rope. And so that's been really cool and an opportunity just to, again, be with family, be with the community. We had some neighborhood kids come over last night for it. From a business perspective, what has been awesome is that it's forced us to do some things that we probably already needed to do. And, you know, we have digital content, you know, we impact our customers from a digital perspective in a certain way. And we've had to really ratchet that up because there's a need for it. And so sometimes these things that happen that are unique, that are challenging, that are adverse, will force you to do some things that you probably should already been doing. And so we've been able to impact our customers in a way from afar that we weren't able to do that before, or didn't do that before, I should say. We were able to do it, but we didn't do it as much before. And so that's been a really awesome opportunity.
How about you, Harry?
First of all, I can't get my mind off of the fact that DJ said he likes to do legs.
What, man? What?
I don't think he's ever done a leg exercise in his life. And maybe he has. It's just been body weight, which is not a lot to begin with. So, like, which is great for him. I shouldn't talk because I need to lose some pounds. But let's not pretend that the Eitzen household does any leg exercises.
All legs, man.
Curls. It's just curls and upper body.
It's just so that he can look good on the Zoom calls. It's just waist up. That's all you got to exercise.
It's just upper body, exactly. No, I mean, so that's one way to do it, right? That's one way to do it. And so I can respect that. But you know, I think that you know, again, it kind of goes back to the togetherness. And you know, I was telling DJ about what our neighborhood did, and it was cool. Like, I lived in this place called Anchorage, Kentucky, which is a suburb of, like, an eastern suburb of Louisville. And you know, at 8 o'clock on whatever day it was, everybody went out on their porches or their front yards and basically just made some noise, right? Like banging pots and pans, honking horns, ringing bells, whatever it was. And it was cool because, I mean, you know, it was just kind of that sign of solidarity. You know, you could see your neighbor from across the street or next to you, you know, and we are trying to practice the social distancing and you know, you really just aren't seeing each other. It's weird. It's odd, especially in a community that, you know, you walk to school and you see folks and you stand in front of school and whatever it might be. And so again, that togetherness is pretty special. I think that's the bright side, if you will, of, you know, coronavirus, if there's one, you know, and it's tough, right? I mean, it's hard for a lot of the folks that are listening. It's hard to kind of find a bright side in this thing, right? It sucks. You know, it sucks because it's disrupting kind of our everyday and the things we love about, you know, living, right? You know, for those that want to hit the gym, you can't do it, right? For those who have their favorite coffee shop to sit in there and take their time, can't do it. It's March Madness and we're not having the tournament, right? Just things that seem that honestly really don't feel like they matter. They seem almost frivolous or extras, but it's just a part of our everyday. So it's hard to wrap your mind around, and it's kind of eerie and quiet and the whole nine. So it's tough. But I mean, I think that, you know, from a business perspective, we are having to show up. Right, we have to show up and be nimble and be accountable. We have to think about our core values, right, and how we're presenting ourselves to our clients and our you know, and our stakeholders and you know, providing value regardless of the revenue play, providing value, right? And what's most important to our customer? What do they need right now? What kind of empathy can we show towards our client? And I think if we are able to do that and do it authentically, you know, the rest will come, right? You know, we want to be a partner with our clients. We want them to see us as a part of, you know, just another appendage of their business. And so I think now we have the time and opportunity to show up, right? And I think that's what, you know, if there's a good side to this thing, is it's providing an opportunity for us to do that.
Yeah, I would love to talk a little bit about how this whole coronavirus has affected your business. As you were talking about, you know, kind of changing the way you're looking at things and trying to figure out, you know, ways in which you can maybe refine your offerings in order to make the biggest impact on your people. So just curious, what practical things are you doing differently on a day-to-day basis, or how is it affecting, you know, the way you are interacting with your clients?
You know, it's been a deep breath and, like, kind of, you know, drilling forward. What we built a business on is, you know, our digital learning content, right? That's what's sustainable. That's what's scalable in our business, is the digital learning platform where we can bring the learning to the learner. So good news is that that's really needed right now, right? Right this very moment. I think where it's impacted our business is just in the live meetings that we have, the keynotes, the leadership summits that are incredibly impactful because, you know, the human touch, the group oriented nature of it, you know, some of the one-on-one stuff, just the actual touch and feel of, you know, certainly motivating the motivated and coming with a message and leaving people feeling like they can run through a wall and also leave with some things that are applicable. Typically for our business, that's been a great generator of what's sustainable and scalable, which is our digital content. So missing out on those opportunities to build those relationships and it's tough, but you know, as many people know, everybody's going virtual now if they hadn't already. And I wish I had some stock in like Zoom or Skype or, you know, GoToMeeting or whatever it is, because there seem to be the businesses that are accelerating during this time. But I think that we're, again, in trying to demonstrate that we're nimble, providing solutions that are virtual, right? And still being able to find ways to create meaningful, you know, first touches, impressions, and really being able to carry that keynote or that leadership summit to the virtual kind of world, right? Some of the stuff we've been able to do with our digital content, some of it's new, right? Some of it, like that nature of taking one individual, maybe a keynote, maybe our CEO, Trevor Mawad, and bringing them into a world that's, you know, in somebody's living room, is still impactful. We have some options, some different things that we've done that actually have amplified it. And so it's been fun to kind of begin to share that with some of our clients and realize that, wow, we actually might even be more scalable, more sustainable than we thought, you know, with the ability to do that. And so once we get on the other side of this thing, I think we're going to be just that much better at engaging with our clients in a lot of different ways. So, you know, we're learning as we go, but I think the cool thing is that our clients are too, right? So we're in this, you know, again, together, we're in this kind of hand in hand saying, hey, what's going to work for you guys? Hey, this will work for us. Perfect. Let's move forward. And so, you know, I think it's just in trying to capture those meaningful moments with our clients that are live that we're looking to solve for.
Yeah, that's awesome. I'm curious, DJ, for you, are there some practical things that you're doing differently in terms of maybe the way you're connecting with clients or maybe it's business as usual? I'm just curious, you know, how's this affecting your day-to-day?
There's two things that are different since this whole coronavirus that I'm seeing. Number one, you know, I think that since we're not on airplanes and jumping from kind of meeting to meeting, live meeting to meeting, we've had an opportunity really as a team to work on some things that we've needed to work on to communicate over these Zoom calls and, you know, touch base on a more regular basis. So I really feel like the creativity of the team, the cohesiveness of the team has improved. I think it's laying a foundation because we're a newer company, you know, formed in the last, you know, 2 or 3 years. So this has allowed us to really build a strong foundation for our team. The second thing is, and this is as it relates to the customers, I agree with everything Harry said. And I think we have changed and modified some things that are going to take us to the next level. But I think we've built such great relationships and partnerships with our customers. Harry and I spend a lot of time just reaching out to our customers on a personal level and not really talking about business at all because we care about them. We want to know, we've gotten to know their families, their interests. And what we realize is that we've always approached this business as transformational, not transactional. And we know that the people that we've been able to impact and that have impacted us in business, we want to reach out to them on a personal level and see how they're doing. So that's something else that, you know, we've had more time to do, obviously, because, you know, we're not traveling as much and we've really taken full advantage of that.
Yeah, I think that's key, you know, in thinking about other executives where, you know, maybe they do have a little bit more time on their hands, you know, reaching out with people, whether it be people below you that, you know, you've been meaning to call and check in on or customers, whatever it would be, I think would be super important. For people who are listening kind of on that leadership level, what are some things that they could be doing or some ideas of things that leadership can be doing to help their companies and help the people that they lead?
I saw a really awesome clip that Simon Sinek put out on, I think I saw it on LinkedIn or Instagram Live or something. And he was just talking about empathy. And that was really, I thought it was just a really clear and honestly should be easy, you know, concept to apply as a leader right now, right? You know, I mean, we have to step up as leaders, and it's not like in pounding the table. It's not necessarily in strategy. Those are all things that are important, you know, building strategy. But I think as we interface with our people, the level of empathy that is required right now is really non-negotiable, I think, with our people, with our peers, with our clients, with other stakeholders to our business, is just understanding that everyone is going through a time of uncertainty. And, you know, the engine that you normally would drive with, you know, which might be with a sense of urgency, with which might be with, you know, this kind of, you know, closing business or whatever, you know, I mean, whatever is going to kind of, you know, move your business along, might just have to take a different approach, right? I think this level of empathy is a part of leadership that, you know, I've always wanted to work on. I feel like I'm an empathetic person, but at all times I find myself like not being as empathetic as I should be and kind of being more of a driver of, you know, results and, you know, concerned about the right behaviors it takes to do X, Y, and Z and so on and so forth, which, you know, in some cases affords, you know, really well, but in other cases, not so much. I think this is one of those times where patience and empathy are, you know, tremendously important. And so I know for me, I'm trying just to be really, really conscious of my level of empathy, you know, on a daily basis. And I challenge our, you know, our listeners to identify ways they can be more empathetic and proactively, maybe even find an accountability partner to help them be more empathetic, right? Call me out if I'm being, hey, especially as a leader, like, let's make sure that when we leave here, like, that's a part of our, that's a, like a leading part of our charge, you know? And let's make some decisions over these next 6, 8, 12 weeks or beyond around empathy to our people, to our clients, et cetera. So that's, you know, that's probably what I'm really trying to bring to the forefront from a leadership perspective that I'd ask our listeners to maybe think about too.
Yeah, I love that, Harry. Empathy, I think, is huge, especially during this time. And I can see how that would be something that leaders could work on. DJ, do you have anything to add to that? I'm curious what you have to think.
I really try to stress, and I try to do this whether we're in the midst of a coronavirus or just general business, but like really try to slow down to speed up and, you know, slow down to speed up. So what I mean by that is like, we've been forced to slow down here and really kind of think about our teams, think about what's important, like Harry's alluding to and talking about, you know, just having the empathy and really caring about your team enough so that they want to run through a wall for you, right? So caring about and showing your family and giving them the time and being present enough that, you know, they want to run through a wall for you. And so whether you're being forced to slow down, right, or you learn from this situation and say, when life does start to speed up again, well, how do I take those moments to be present and slow down so that I can advance and really maximize my potential? And so that's one thing that stands out. The other thing is, and I've seen Jess, my wife, model this. At dinner, we go around the table. We talk about the best part of the day and the worst part of the day. And we've been able to do that, you know, all week this week, right, you know, since we're home. And it's been awesome. But we added something though, because I could see that throughout the week, you know, my wife was feeling a little bit beat up in terms of just like, you know, the kids are asking for a lot on a lot of different levels. So I made them, you know, all say one thing that they really appreciated and liked about Jess. And my one daughter, Jada, who's usually, you know, she's really kind of I call her a swizzle stick. She's always stirring the pot. And she said that she likes that mommy's patient. And I think as leaders, you know, we have to exercise patience. That's something that the people we're leading see. That's something they gravitate towards, they acknowledge. And I think it's something that really stands great leaders apart. We talk a lot and we teach neutral thinking with our training with Limitless Minds, and being patient and like really stepping back and just pausing instead of reacting is a big part of being neutral. And so that's another thing that I think that executives can demonstrate and carry through, whether it's in the corona situation or after.
That's good. It's funny how we learn things sometimes from our kids. So that's really cool. I wanted to kind of hit on something that Harry said there. He was talking about having empathy. And I'm just curious, you know, sometimes when you're having empathy, you kind of have to put yourself in the shoes of the people that you're having empathy for. So I'm just curious for you guys, like, what do you think are some of the like big issues that people are facing during this time? You know, maybe your workers or just the community at large that people are really struggling with.
I think the first thing that comes to mind is just security, right? You know, the security for their job and thus, you know, their income. You know, there's some companies, whether it be a restaurant, whether it be a gym, whether it be, you know, other organizations that are having to lay off people, or if they haven't, they're going to have to make some tough choices coming up, right? And that's tough, man. I mean, like, because those are choices that nobody wants to make, especially relative to something like this that nobody could really see coming. You know, planning for this is tough. It's hard to forecast for this type of thing, right? And so, And nobody wants to make choices like that. But I mean, I can imagine, you know, people feeling insecure. I mean, you know, as a small business owner, right? Not only the employees, but then as small business owners that might be listening to this, it's like, and entrepreneurs and start, you know, folks that are co-founders of startups and whatnot, you know, everything's about momentum. You know, it seems like momentum is so key. And what a big momentum killer something like this can be, right? You know, the cool thing is that if we kind of fight through this time, right? If we can find a way to just not like, you know, it's gonna be hard to grow through this time unless you're, you know, certain companies that are providing solutions for what we're in, right? But like, if you can fight through this time, then we can create a different, you know, kind of another, you know, heat of momentum, right? And so I think you're always, whether you're a team, whether you're an organization, you know, in business, no matter what, right? Like momentum, you're always searching for momentum, especially as leaders. Like, you're always trying to find momentum. And then once you're in it, once you're kind of like saddled up with it, how far and fast can you go with it, right? Mm-hmm. Momentum is not going to last forever. And that's okay, right? It's how far and fast can I go? What kind of impact can I make while we're in it? And so right now we're probably in a lull from a momentum perspective. And for me, you know, as a small business owner, you know, like it kind of bums you out, right? You're like, damn, like we were rocking and rolling. We're doing this. Now we got to figure out, now we got to, you know, reshape this. Now we got to, you know, pivot over here. And it's annoying, right? It's annoying. It's that's what, simple as put, it's just annoying, right? It doesn't mean that you don't have to ignore the fact that it's happened. And that's where, you know, DJ was talking about neutral. Like, we don't have to ignore it. It's not about like ignoring negative. It's just about acknowledging. In fact, it's opposite. Acknowledging it, going to the facts, and then moving on without judgment. I think the challenge with neutral here is just that what are the facts, right? We're still kind of collecting them, right? And so while we're waiting on some of the facts to be identified, I think the next thing you go to is choices. You know, what choices can we make, right? Negativity is everywhere right now, from politics to obviously, you know, anytime you turn the TV on, COVID-19 is there, and some of it's overlapped with politics, right? And so it's hard to avoid it. So really, it's just a choice that you make, right? If it's on CNN, if it's on Fox News, if it's on, just don't turn the TV on, right? You know, or don't turn the station on, just watch a movie, whatever it is. You know, there's certain choices you're going to make on daily that are going to either allow you to, you know, kind of avoid negativity or be like, you know, face to face with it. It's your call, right? That's, you have full control over it for the most part. And so I think that that's what people are facing the most, is just like this uncertainty, which, you know, just kind of questions their security and both, you know, and everything they're doing. And we get it. I'm going through it too, you know?
Yeah, that's awesome. DJ, curious if you have something to weigh in on that.
I'm really just trying to be mindful of what I'm taking in, you know, like Harry said, like, what am I watching? What am I verbalizing? How much news am I consuming? Because it's a fine line between getting information and then starts to become just a lot of garbage in and then garbage out. And so I think that that's the thing. Now we're in our house. Well, how are we occupying our time? You know, let's take a look at your utility feature on your phone, in your iPhone. How much has your consumption of social media or whatever area it is on your phone, how much has it gone up, or has it stayed the same, or has it gone down? Because we have a really unique opportunity to be able to spend time with our families and our kids. And how are we doing that? That's something that's really been kind of heavy on my mind as we're going through this.
As we're kind of wrapping this up, just want to give you guys an opportunity to give some takeaways to our listeners.
In this very unique time, we have an opportunity to be able to change the way we do business, change the way we do parenting, change the way we have, you know, our relationship with our spouse and our children. What are we doing to become ultimately the best version of ourselves? We talk about, you know, what it takes to influence people. And now we have this time to improve ourselves in a way that we can have maximum influence on the people around us, whether it's the people we're leading, people we're serving, the people that we're just interacting with from a friendship standpoint. And so I'm really taking that seriously. I would challenge the listeners to take that seriously too as well. And let's all be room tilters.
And I've talked about it on this particular episode quite a bit, but and it struck me this week is just like really leveling up my level of empathy. I'm hoping and praying that coronavirus doesn't hit my home. It may or may not. Sometimes when things aren't, you know, in your sphere, you know, you tend to treat it a certain way, right? You don't really necessarily relate to it or whatever. But, you know, this is impacting homes and businesses across the nation, across the globe. So I'm just really trying to reflect on where I can be more empathetic. And then also, you know, where I can be more grateful. Something that our team does, and Matt, you know this well, and DJ, you know, you really started this thing, which was on our daily calls that we have with our team, we're called just the daily update. You know, everything, it always starts off with what we're grateful for. And it's impactful. It's funny, you know, Matt, you probably agree, like, sometimes, especially if you haven't thought about it during the day, you know, for some reason, you're like, okay, crap, what am I grateful for? And you start feeling bad, like, hey, how am I not grateful for something? You know, maybe it's just because you did it yesterday and the day before and the day before that. So it's, we challenge ourselves to think about what we're grateful for on a daily basis. And it's something that's really been great because, you know, it's forced, and sometimes it's something little, right? Like, I'm grateful for coffee, right? Or I'm grateful for something much bigger, you know, or whatever, family and all that, all those things. But it's also cool to think that way and maybe even communicate some of that stuff to your teams. For those that are listening, if you have teams or your family, you know, what are you grateful for? Because it actually is a nice little peek behind the curtain on, you know, your people and your peers on like what's important to them. So then I think that allows you to increase your empathy, right? Because you kind of, you know what's important to people, and especially if you can identify that something's being taken away from them that falls under that bucket, it's a lot easier to be empathetic around, you know, those types of things because you're fully aware, right? You're fully aware of things that are being taken away or compromised. So that's something I would challenge people on, is to level up their empathy, to identify what they're grateful for on a daily basis, share what they're grateful for to whomever it might be, right? And then if they're a part of a group or family, ask, you know, other people how they're doing, again, leveling up your empathy, and also ask them what they're grateful for. So you can share that and celebrate that with them, especially during this time. It's like, if you can find something daily you're grateful for, hopefully this coronavirus thing, we kick its ass, we look up and we're better for it, right? And also we're significantly more grateful, you know, during this time. And so that's my call to action, if you will.
Thanks, Harry. Before we, you know, let you guys go to whatever calls you have next, I wanted to hit you guys with a few rapid fire questions. Is that cool?
Yeah, love it.
All right, here we go. What was the last thing you watched on Netflix?
Well, I mean, I watched some last night. Marvelous Mrs. Maisel.
Nice, good one.
Have you seen that?
Oh yeah.
Yeah, it's pretty good. My wife loves it. I think it's funny.
DJ, what about you?
We watched Glory Road, Texas Western team that beat Kentucky.
Nice. Cool. Okay, next one for you guys. What items did you stock up on when you heard we might be quarantined?
You know, yesterday I drove way over the speed limit to go to Evergreen Liquors down the street from us to get as much wine as we could and other essentials, just in case we're really trapped in this house for some period of time. Yeah, I hate to say it, but we stocked up the cabinet. We stocked up the cellar. We don't really have a cellar, just so you know.
How about you, DJ?
We definitely got some Greek yogurt, you know, that's I got to have those. And some of those protein shakes from Costco. We had those delivered and sent over. One of the funniest things is we were at the store. This was like an ice cream run this past weekend. One of the people at the store had 16 milks, right? Like whole milks.
And so
Jess looks at me and she goes, "Hey, DJ," she's like, should we go and get some extra milks? You know, and get, and I'm like, why? What are we going to do with that many milks? You know, but I think it's funny if you think about how, like, you know, when you hear about toilet paper and all these other things that, you know, when you see somebody going and buying something, there is an urge to say, well, should I have more than one milk? Maybe I should have five, you know?
Right.
So, ours is pretty boring, man. We just stocked up on the normal stuff that we think we could use over the next 2 weeks.
All right. Favorite snack during coronavirus?
One thing that I can eat all day and just like pop in my mouth all day is just like a good grape. Like a good grape. And then one of the ones that are like, I like them when they're kind of almost like got a crunch to them. You know what I mean? Like a good solid grape I can crush and put them in the freezer too. Fantastic. And then like my guilty pleasure snack during a time like this is like, it's really guilty, but an Oreo. Mm. I'm a big Oreo fan, which is a problem. You got to keep those out of the house.
Yeah.
But those are kind of like just snacks I'll just crush at any given time.
How about you, DJ?
I gave up a bunch of really awesome foods during this time for Lent. Typically, I would probably say like pizza or ice cream or, you know, cookies or something along those lines. But I've been eating these beef sticks, these honey beef jerky sticks from Bellevue, Ohio, and they're fantastic. And so that's kind of been my go-to snack.
This nice. Message sponsored by Honey Beef Stick.
I love it. What's one activity you wish you could be doing?
I like going to the gym. And, you know, I'm actually at my office right now. I can see the rec center across the way. And so I miss going up there after work or before work. And so I miss that.
Yeah, I mean, I'm missing Orange Theory, you know, hitting that up. And then this is the time of year where I start, like, you know, doing some yard work and cutting grass and stuff. And I like it this time of year. Like, in July, it gets old, right? But, like, March, when you get back out there, it's kind of, like, nice to kind of get out there and get some work done. So, you know, that I can do, but the weather just isn't quite where I need it to be yet, you know?
All right, this will be our last question. I know you guys got to run here, but do you guys ever work in your pajamas?
Nope. No. Because I don't really, like, my pajamas are not much, you know what I mean? So that's one
of, that would get awkward real quick.
You know, I think the reason, probably DJ, same thing, and probably people listening that are kind of working at home now, it's, I think there's something to, like, showering, shaving, whatever, right? Putting on whatever you would normally wear when you go to work. You know, you don't have to suit up if that's what you normally wear, but it's getting dressed and feeling good about yourself. Never pajamas, no.
Yeah, no, I'm the same way, man. I gotta get up, get dressed. You know, Harry, you saw today. I had a nice white collar shirt on. You know, Harry seemed to.
Yeah, but that was different, man. Like, that was something different because usually you're wearing, like, a Limitless Minds T-shirt, right? Which kind of gets you in the right frame of mind. Like, you're going to. I don't know if you are you interviewing somewhere. That's what I want to know. Like, you interviewing? Are you heading out? Like, you basically get, like, a interview, like, for, like, a regional, like, a national sales manager? Like, what's happening?
You know, you always got to stay on your game, you know?
That's true.
This has been awesome, Matt. We're gonna do this again. You did a great job. Awesome.
Thanks for subbing in as a host of the Room Tilters podcast. It's nice to be in the other. It's, like, nice to be in the passenger seat.
Yeah, my pleasure. Loved having it. Excited to talk to you guys and pick your brains a little bit. And I hope our listeners enjoyed it as well.
You've been listening to the Room Tilters podcast, hosted by DJ Eitzen and Harry Wilson, presented by Limitless Minds.